Good morning, everybody. My name is Felix Simonis. I'm a researcher at the Technical University of Munich and one of the core developers of Precise. And it's my pleasure to present to you what happened since the last workshop. So let's start with a little flashback to last workshop. What have we done there? So in general, there were a lot of productive hands-on sessions. There was a lot of discussions with us to the users and between the users. There was a world cafe that allowed us to pin to very specifically ask for feedback in specific areas, and there was a user support session afterwards. So all in all, this resulted in tons of feedback, and the feedback that we got, we post-processed, we also showed this feedback in a post on the discourse. And the condensed feedback of this looks a bit like this here. So first of all, documentation was one of the biggest issues here. People, as well as sometimes developers, just didn't find the required documentation. So one of the big points was to restructure the documentation and the website, because the latter isn't really useful. Furthermore, we should extend the tutorials on writing adapters. Also, a step-by-step guide would be very neat, as well as some kind of quick start. Then, furthermore, we should provide some kind of reference implementation. So a virtual machine that would contain Precise as well as the adapters and the tutorials, so that a user or a potential user could just download this thing and then play with it without having to go through the hassle of setting everything up. Furthermore, another common request was solver-based data mapping. This is something we couldn't address until now, but it is a major issue that we are trying to implement in the future. Furthermore, error messages in general were very confusing and misleading, and in some cases just plain wrong. So we should invest in that, and we did. More on that later. Then also there was the building experience, which was a bit hiccupy, so we tried to smoothen this. And based on this, we also invested in Spark, and given on community feedback, we should also keep investing in Spark, because it makes things easier for our HPC environments and such. And finally, we should create YouTube videos, because this is a very good way of just showcasing common use cases and common hiccups. So with this in mind, let's just see what happened. So this presentation is a three-part presentation. The first part contains the features and the changes in the Precise library itself. The second part contains mostly the outlook of what is going to be added to Precise. And the third part contains the ecosystem, it's the ecosystem. So everything around the library. So let's start with a little timeline here. On the top, we have the last Precise workshop, and the bottom here, we have the last release. So let's start from the top. The version 2.0, including the changes on the changes between 1 and 2, the porting guide and more specifics were already covered by me in the last workshop. So you can just check out the following video, which is on YouTube. You can just have a look at this again for more information. So after the workshop, we, as I said, we received a lot of feedback. So we had some minor releases here, or hot fixes actually, where we implemented some of the feedback from the user sessions. And this mainly contains compatibility, some bug fixes, and building errors, things like this. Then another major step for us is version 2.1. What we did here is we had a serious look at the error messages, the general state in Precise, and we came to the conclusion that it was just not good enough. Error messages were misleading, they were incomplete, some were actually missing. So we decided to just have a look at every single one of them, reword them, extend them, and add further checks just to simplify the life of users. Then what we also did was we added the support for quads. More on that later. These are all just highlights. So another big feature is a parallel RBF mapping method that does not require a patsy. So this wasn't implemented before, so you got an error message when you tried to configure something like this. Now we have a very inefficient, but it works, fallback for this. We also clarified some action timings. The naming was a bit misleading, and we tried to just clarify this. We improved the convergence measure logging in greater detail, and we reduced the verbosity of the profiling. So when you ran precise, you always got this big table at the end, which tells you the different events that we captured inside precise and how long they take. But this is not really interesting for the majority of people, so it was a big waste of vertical space in the output. So after that, in 2.1, we had a user that told us about Intel compiler problems. So we worked on some fixes to improve the compatibility here. So if you ran into problems, this is the you should at least upgrade to this version. Of course, you should always upgrade to the latest version, but that's another story. And finally, the version 2.2.0. Here we had some major features in, again. Like now you can actually define multiple mappings from and to a mesh. So this allows to construct more interesting and more complex mappings between meshes of your own solver. Very interesting. Then you can now also define watch integrals, so in contrast to watch points, so all meshes. Then we also improved the support for macOS. So Preces now builds on macOS. We fixed some of the issues here. And we now have also documentation about this. Then we had to upgrade to C++ 14, which is actually quite fortunate for us because we always wanted to do it, but we never had a real reason to do it. And now we were required to do it due to dependency. And finally, one of the bigger problems also that we discovered in the workshop is that most people run into problems with patsy installations that Precise cannot find, or CMake cannot find the patsy installation. So we had to invest more here and make this all more robust. So what I presented to you was the overview of what changed. So now we dive deeper into the different changes, and for this I grouped the highlights into two parts. So first we have the features, and then we have the improvements. So let's start with the features. First we have the support for quads. So we always used to have those IPI methods to set quads either by the edges or with edges, so just by the vertices. And we now finally implemented this. What we do is we require this the parsed quad to be planar, and the reason for this is that we need to take some assumption on the surface of a primitive for the projection mappings, and this doesn't make sense if the plat is not corner for us, as a planar for us. So this is implemented in a way that we triangulate the quad, so we split along the longest diagonal. If there is no longest diagonal, we try to keep the first three vertices together, so and put those into one triangle. And this doesn't really matter for the end user, but as a consequence, if you use something like a VTK export, this will contain the triangulated mesh and not the quads that you set via the interface. So keep this in mind. Furthermore, we now have a parallel version for the RVF mapping, which works without patsy. So just to give you some context, Precise builds an interpolant using the mesh and the radial basis function that you configured, and then solves one or more linear systems. So if you build Precise with patsy and you use patsy, this uses GMRS to solve the systems. And this works for both parallel and serial participants. So up to now, if you didn't have PATSY, we would fall back to an eigen implementation, which generally is simply a QR decomposition with a triangular solve. And this works for CL participants. What's new now is that this also works for parallel participants. And what we do here is a very naive and simple getter scatter. So the idea here is that this may be slow and inefficient, but it works. So if you then still want to use this eigen implementation while you compile it with PATSY, then you can request this by specifying use QR decomposition equals true. So you can still use this for validating, for example, your PATSY version, basically. Kyle Davis will present a talk about data mapping in Precise, and he will present you more information on this. So this may be interesting. And the talk will be also in this workshop. Next is the parallel mapping. Mappings, here we lifted some constraints. We used to have the constraint that you were only allowed to specify single mapping between meshes. And now this constraint is gone, which makes life difficult for us, but not for you. And this actually allows you to do some interesting cases. So here, for example, we have a configuration where you have a participant B, participant A, and the participant B writes some data to a middle mesh. This gets transferred to participant A, and participant A has now two mappings that map to an A top and an A bottom mesh, and the participant can then read from those two different meshes. This didn't work before this change. Another way you can do this is by turning this around. So in this case, A writes to two meshes, so the A and the A top and the A bottom. Then we have two mappings that map onto the middle mesh. And then this middle mesh gets transferred over to B, and B will read from this. So this basically sums up the data points that are located on A top and A bottom, sums them up on the middle mesh, and then transfers them over. Another major feature that we introduced was the addition of watch integrals. So until 2.2, you could only specify watch points. And now you can also specify a watch integral in a mesh. And the use cases here are quite simple. So let's say you want to determine the total force on a geometry in a FSI simulation, for example, or you want to determine the flow rate in a fluid-fluid coupling, something like this. And for these cases, a watch integral can be quite interesting. So what you can do now is specify this watch integral for a whole mesh. And this has basically two different cases. Either your mesh has connectivity information or not. If it has connectivity information, it will by default use a scaled sum. So it will scale up the data that's lying on vertices by the area around it. You can explicitly disable this and say, and in the bottom here, you have an example of this configuration where you use a watch integral and you say scale with connectivity. So default is yes, but you can also say no. And in that case, or in the case where you do not have connectivity information, it will simply sum up all the data that's lying on your vertices on the mesh. So these were the features of the highlights. And let's proceed to the improvements. So first of all, probably the most important one is that we reverted and extended all error messages in Precise. What this means is that we took inspiration from Git. And Git has this idea that when you do something in Git and it is wrong, then Git will tell you, first of all, what went wrong, and second of all, how to proceed from here. So to either make a suggestion or to specifically tell you a command that you have to do to escape, for example. So based on this, we developed a guideline. First of all, use names for meshes, data, and participants. Why? Because mesh IDs, etc., are simply not useful outside of Precise, and they're actually meaningless outside of Precise. So we should also always be explicit about what happened and what was involved in it, also to give the user context and to be able to resolve the issue. Then state what actually went wrong. So basically make the as detailed as possible, and then provide a next step if that is possible. So this could be a configuration example, this could be a link to documentation, or it could be actually instructions on what to do. And as a little example here, for example, if you configure to use data of a mesh which doesn't actually use data in the configuration, then the old error message would be something along the lines of data with enforcers is not defined on mesh with RD1. So the new error message you would get for this is data with name enforcers is not defined on mesh fruit mesh. Please add use data name under the mesh name blah blah tag. So you know what to insert, where to fix this issue. So next up is a small change that may sound like a minor deal, but it is actually quite a big deal for specific cases. Presize will now reset write data, so data that the user writes in every call to advance. Why? It is actually a very common mistake to simply forget to write data in implicit coupling. And the big problem here is because the data that is used to be persistent, the data always remained the same, but it looked realistic because it was persistent. And this was sometimes extremely difficult to debug. So we just took the decision to do this in every case because the upside is just so dramatic that it is just worth it. And yeah, so the solution was that for every data that you write in your participant, we will reset it in every call to advance. So as I said, minuscule impact, but a major gain. Another small change here is the reduction of the verbosity of the profiling. So as an example here, you have the output of a single participant, and often when the participant ends, you get a scenario like this, where half of a vertical space is filled with those tables there, and you're not really interested in those tables because the tables just tells you how long different events took inside Presize. So this is not important for the majority of people. So it is still important for specific people that want to fine-tune things. So what we instead did is that we just write this bottom part to a file. So if you have a solver A, then it's Presize A events dash summary.log. And you can just have a look at it. The same information is still there, but it now doesn't pollute the output of the participant anymore. Furthermore, we clarified action timings. And this is a bit more interesting and more intriguing to explain. So here we have a scenario where A writes some data, it gets transferred somehow over to B, and B reads the data. So A has a mesh A, B has a mesh B, A writes to mesh A, and B reads from mesh B. So now you have two possibilities on how to configure this because you have this mapping. And the mapping can either happen on the participant A, or it can happen the participant B. So in case of so in the first case, you have the mapping that happens on the data that was basically written from participant A. And this is what we called a write mapping, because the user writes the data, we execute the write mapping onto mesh B, or the copy of mesh B, and the data then gets transferred to B, and B reads from it. That's the top part. In the case, the bottom case here, we receive information, and then we need to execute a mapping where the participant will then read from the resulting mesh. So the participant A sends writes data to the mesh, the data gets transferred, and the execute the mapping gets executed on this received data. And this mapping is what we called a read mapping. So on the one side you have the write mapping, on the other side we have the read mapping. So there used to be the old version of this of our action timings used to be called regular prior and regular post. And regular prior was basically an action that you could configure and that would run on the result of the write mapping. So this is local to participant A. And after the write mapping has been done, the action will be called on the resulting data before it gets transferred to mesh B. On the other hand, a regular post action would be run after the data would be mapped in read mapping. So it would run here on the mesh B, or on the data of mesh B. And because this is confusing and not really expressive, we decided to just use the explicit name of this and also give you more options here. So as I said, you have the write mapping and the read mapping. So what we have now are two action timings that you can use, always prior post per mapping. So in the first case here, you have the write mapping prior. In the second case, you have the write mapping post and the read mapping prior and read mapping post. So you can now have more fine-grained control about what to use in what case. So next up are strict convergence measures. This was just a minor little improvement for the convergence measures. So you can now define or declare a convergence measure as strict. And what that means is if this convergence measure is not fulfilled, it will terminate the simulation. And the main use case for this is where you simply don't want a simulation to consume just unnecessary resources, especially when you're on a cluster and you have a specific CPU budget. So you can then just define your convergence measure and declare it as strict as shown here in the example. Furthermore, we improved and extend the convergence measure logging. So if we use a very similar example from before, the old log output was something along so relative convergence measure and then two norm div and relative limit, and then whether it converged yes or no. So we made this a bit more explicit. And we now tell you, okay, this is actually a relative two norm div that we have here. We give you the limits and the normalization and so on and so forth. So you have more information to base your reasoning on, basically. In terms of files, we have two files that are interesting for convergence measures and as well as general iteration and acceleration. First of all, we have the iterations log that tells you the amount of iterations it took per time window and when it converged or not. And what we can do now, or what you can do now or see now, is how many quasi-Newton colons there actually were, how many were deleted, and how many were dropped. And this should give you some more detailed information on to fine-tune your quasi-Newton acceleration. On the bottom here, we have the convergence file. And this used to be very hard to read because the header of this file was quite nonsensical. It didn't contain the names of the data. So what we did now is we refactored this a bit. So now you can actually see what type of convergence measure it is and what data it is based on. So for example, here we have a relative one, which is based on the temperature data. Next up is the improved support for macOS. So a big shout out to Us, who did this basically one-handedly. He ported Preside to macOS Catalina 10.15. And he's also working on CI for macOS. So we have the hardware, we just need to implement the software now. So the bugs that were still in Preside are fixed. Fixes are released. In a nutshell, you can use a Brewer port to install the dependencies here, get the sources as usual, and build Preside as usual. And it should really all work out of the box now. Another a nice little improvement for us, at least, is that we upgrade to C++ 14. So this was long planned, but we never had the real intensive to do it because, it lifts requirements, and we couldn't justify this until now. And finally, Boost Geometry requires C++ 14 now in version 1.75. So we will proceed and then also lift the version to C++ 14. And this will not be so much noticeable to you, but it will allow us to clean up the internals a lot. And it will allow us to do many improvements in the direction of code quality and maintainability. What will be noticeable by you is that we have now already proceeded to mark deprecated API methods as deprecated. So now when you use them in your solver, you get a warning as such. Here at the bottom, for example, you have the warning that you use has to evaluate a surrogate model. And it tells you that this is no longer supported, and this is done by the compiler itself. So you don't need to read up documentation anymore. The compiler tells you that this is deprecated. So in terms of requirements, the GCC toolchain doesn't change at all, because we always required a relatively lately implemented feature by GCC, which is the IO streams for dates, I think it was. So there's actually no change in requirement here for GCC. For Intel, you have a little change of requirement from version 15 to 17. This also requires GCC 5 because they don't ship an standard library anymore. Same for Cray, you have a slight improvement, as a slight lift in requirement from 8.4 to 8.6. Again, this requires GCC 5, and Clang has a little lift from 3.3 to 3.4. So this is really an ancient version of Clang. Another major feature, major because many people ran into this problem, is the Patsy discovery. So we always used the community-provided find Patsy for CMake, which led to quite a few problems over the last years. And now there is an official statement that CMake users should use a package config to detect Patsy and to extract the requirements from that. And so that's what we did. And I developed a package config wrapper that acts as a complete drop-in replacement. So if it used to work, it will work now. And the idea here was to be more, be a bit more verbose. So for example, it will tell, it, so the, this new wrapper will tell the user what prefixes it considered to find Patsy, and tells also the user what prefixes were not used because they were invalid, because there was no package config file there, etc., etc. And this works on all distributions except CentOS due to some problems with their package config files. This leads us to part two of this talk, which is the outlook. And again, I split this into two parts. You have the part before version 3, and you have the part of version 3 and beyond. So first of all, this is a recurring topic here, is the two-level parallel initialization. where the basic idea is that you don't have where you don't gather the mesh on the master rank anymore. And this allows for much larger meshes. This is close to complete. It doesn't yet cover all corner cases. So it's not enabled by default. You can enable it explicitly using two level, using in the M2N, use two level init on. There was a talk scheduled for last workshop, which sadly didn't take place. However, there will be a talk tomorrow in this workshop by Amin Totunferush regarding the two-level, two-step parallel initialization. In terms of usability for the parallel RBF, we did already go far. So before the revamp of the error messages in Precise, we had messages, we had an error message like this, interpolation matrix C is not invertible. This doesn't mean anything to a user until they read the reference paper, which should not be a requirement to use software. So we changed this slightly in 2.1 when we revamped the error messages. Now we say that the linear system from mesh A, so of the RBF mapping from mesh A to mesh B has not converged, so at least you know actually which mapping is the issue here. And then it also tells you that this means most likely that the problem is not well posed. So please check that your coupling meshes are correct. Sounds funny, but it's very easy and very common to swap, for example, coordinates or axes. And this doesn't result in anything meaningful. Also, you should fix max axis aligned mapping setups by making perpendicular axes as dead. So you can mark axes as dead, and these will then not be respected in the creation of the linear systems mentioned above. So, but there are still open problems or issues here. So, for example, what actually went wrong? We don't know, right? So it just tells you that something didn't work, but it doesn't tell you why. So what went wrong? Then did it actually diverge, or did it just stop because it couldn't converge to the limit that you specified, and it just reached the maximum iterations? So what are the different residual limits? That's also not very clear here. Also, if it converged, how many iterations did it actually take? Or now, based on this, maybe I don't want to wait 10,000 iterations, but as I say, I have a very simple system, and it should converge within 100 iterations or something like that. And I set the maximum to 1,000 so that it stops quicker. And the other part here is, so can I have some convergence lock here so that if I have an if I run this PETSI mapping more often, or RBF mapping in general more often, that I can see how my mapping behaves, or how also so how this this these solvers work, how they behave. And then, of course, based on this, I can fine-tune my method. So I need some more configuration options to do so, like setting the maximum iterations and things like this. This is something we also want to look into. Then, as I mentioned before, we have a parallel RBF mapping now that works without PETSI. And currently, this is this gather then solve scatter method. And the problem is that this is, of course, a very imbalanced in terms of compute and memory resources. So this all runs on a single rank. And this is an implementation that works. So you can use it as a reference. Desire would, of course, be a proper parallel sparse decomposition and parallel solve. And this is something that we haven't planned, but we would really like to do in the future. So to give this, so do not completely rely on PETSI for this case. Another major point here is Windows support. So this is an ongoing task, and we're currently targeting Visual Studio Community 2019. There has already been quite some progress on this, and we made progress, and not the majority, but many of the fixes have already been released. So as I said, this is on the radar. We want to come up with a native version of this, and it is an ongoing task. So stay tuned. We will probably let you know when there's some major breakthrough here. Also, this here is an old slide from the last workshop. You may remember it. So we want to extend the nearest projection for volume coupling. What that means is that we need to map on, currently we map on interfaces, meaning that if you have a 3D interface, you map on 2D surfaces. But what we would need is a 3D interface where we map onto the 3D volumes. And this involves many changes in the mapping scheme, etc. And we'd also need to add 3D elements like tetrahedra and octahedra. Another continuous problem is that we do not have a very resource efficient way for mapping contiguous data. What that basically means is if your solver used to be configured in a file exchange way, so where you just would exchange arrays in the coupling, and you wanted to use precise, the best you could do, or what we can offer at the moment, is to use nearest neighbor. So this is a spatial method, so it then tries to find the nearest neighbors on an entire tree, etc. But this is, we should, so of course we can do better, but we currently have nothing implemented yet. So if you have this range-based system on the right-hand side here, where you know that specific ranks have specific partitions of your mesh, or of the data that they exchange, basically your mesh, then our idea would be to reduce this to a problem of finding subranges and just copying subranges. So this should be super resource efficient and very, very fast. Another recurring point here is the bulk functions for setting meshes. So currently you have a bulk function to set many vertices in one go. What we would also like is functions for setting many edges in one go, and then later also for setting many triangles in one go. This just removes the overhead of input sanitation for every single call and just allows us to do this in one go and then efficiently apply this to the actual meshes. This was the outlook for everything before version 3. What we want to do now is have a quick look at all the features that that are aimed at version 3 and beyond that. And most of them have already been presented during last workshop. So what I'm going to show you now is some kind of guide for you to get more information on this. And this is the guide to the major features. So these will be publications, some future publications that you can have a look at to get more understanding on these specific mappings. So let's start. So we have the geometric multiscale mapping by Gerasimos Jodakis, and he has an upcoming poster at the SIAM CSE 21. So if you're there, if you're attending, please just check out his poster. Then we have consistent time interpolation that was presented by Benjamin Ritt back in the last workshop, and this video is up on our YouTube channel, so feel free to go and check it out. Then I recently gave a presentation on the dynamic adaptive meshes that I gave at the ECOMAS WCCM 2020 that was held now at the beginning of this year. And you can follow this link here to see the presentation on Slides Live. Then a new contender here is the macro-micro coupling, and this is a feature, or is a bigger picture plan for something that Benjamin Ackermann will present also during this workshop So you can also follow this link here to check it out. So let's now proceed to the final part of this presentation, which is everything related to the Prezis ecosystem, so everything around the library. Let's start with the tutorials. So we started a restructure of the tutorials some time ago, but we sadly couldn't finish it till the workshop, so apologies for this. So the current format of our tutorials are that we have folders for specific physics. And inside those physics solvers, we have case folders for a specific case. And inside this, we have folders for specific solver combinations. So you can see here, as an example, we have a conjugate heat transfer. Inside there, we have flow over plate. Inside that, we have an example here, which is just a buoyant pimple foam with Phoenix. And this folder then contains all the case files to set up and run this specific case. What we wanted to do in the future is to boil this down to a specific case. So the future format will just be a list of different cases being folders. And inside this will be all the files you require to run this specific case. And to give you an example how this looks like, we have here the perpendicular flap case. And this will then contain different options. So for example, for the fluid side, you have fluid neutrals, fluid open foam, fluid SO2. For the solid side, you have folders for solid calculix, solid TO2, solid Phoenix. And what you do is you select one solver per participant, you run them, and they produce always basically the same results if they model the same physics. So next are some SPAC news. So first of all, we managed to port the Python bindings that we have to SPAC. So we created the SPAC package. It's also merged upstream. Also, XSDK 0.6.0 was released. And this includes Prezis version 2.1.1. At the moment, or in the future, Prezis will or could be pre-installed on your local cluster or supercomputer. And so the idea here was to create a virtual machine that would act a bit of an all-in-one sandbox to test, experiment, or maybe even develop. So what does this virtual machine contain? This virtual machine contains Prezis. It contains all the solvers that we currently have, tutorials, and common tools like ParaView. And to showcase this, I have a little demo for you prepared here. This is now our virtual machine, and we can log in using Vagrant as a user and password. Here we have now the tutorials, we have example codes, and we have here the shared folder. The shared folder is the one that contains the Vagrant file. So you can use this to easily interface between your host system and your guest system here, the virtual machine. Then what you have in here is the other examples. These are the solver dummies that are part of the Prezis installation. And you can, for example, install them here or build them. If you go to the CPP dummy, open your terminal, and then you can here say cmake dot. This will configure your solver dummy and build it, and then you can execute it. And you can run simple examples with this. Furthermore, we have the tutorials. This is the old layout that I mentioned. So as an example here, we can go into FSI. We can use the flap perf, use a combination here, and then just run all run, and it will run the tutorials as you basically used to it. And this is all in a neat little environment, which has some additional tools like ParaView installed. Another major change was the new website. So our problem was that we had distributed documentation, which led to out-of-date links and out-of-date info, confused both the users and the developers. And all of this combined with the website that was barely useful led us to the following strategy. So first of all, we would like to unite and unify all the access to the documentation into one place. We want to do this and integrate it into the website and restructure all the information, make it searchable, to address the major chunk of the feedback that we received during the last workshop. So let me demonstrate. So what we have here is the Prisas website. Let me just give you a brief overview here. So first we have the landing page. Here we have a brief introduction to Prisas, what the major features are, some of the solvers, etc. Then we have the quick start. The quick start includes everything to get Prisas installed, get a fundamental understanding of Prisas, and get your first case run, and then gives you some idea about what to do next. So this is basically a little guide to the rest of the website. Let's skip the documentation for a minute, go over to tutorials. So we also have a new overview for the different tutorials. This is all work in progress and it heavily relies on the restructuring that I mentioned before. As an example here, we have the perpendicular flap and it explains the different setup, the physics, all available solvers, how to run the simulation, etc. And this is directly imported from the tutorials repository. So this will keep up to date. And when you check out the repository to download the tutorials, you also get the up-to-date documentation. Next is the community page. This will mostly be covered by the talk from Garamassimos Shudakis later during the workshop about how to become a good user. What I just would like to point out is that we have here the different events that are currently occurring or upcoming. And on the bottom here, we have the past events. If you want to check out some talks here, you can find them here. Furthermore, we renamed testimonials. They are now called stories. So if you would like to get your work included in the on the website here, please contact us and we'll happily do this. Furthermore, we get we have the publication website here and how to contribute to Prisas, just general publications and communication channels. So next is about the About website. To keep this short, the About page simply showcases the current composition of the Prisas team and just the funding that we have. So this leads us to the blog, and the blog is simply linked to the discourse that you're probably aware of already, which leads us to the documentation. Now we come to the real meat of this rework, which is the documentation. So what we have here is a complete rework of the documentation, and we unified everything into this little page here. So to start off, we have the fundamental part that gives you a big picture overview about Prisas, including our overview picture, and gives you an overview about the documentation, where you find what. Then we have some terminology, which explains, for example, what an adapter is. Then we have the literature guide and roadmap, which are basically copied from the last website. And what's most interesting for the new users here will be the output files section. The point of the output files section here is to include all the different files that Prisas generates during a run. So if you ever wonder what a specific file means, you come here and it will not only explain what it means, what the content means, but also refer you to further documentation and further pages so that you can get a deeper understanding of them. Next up is the installation. So the installation part of the website covers the complete guidelines on how to build presets from source, how to build it using Spark, other systems. It also tells you how to, when you want to build from source, how to prepare everything, how to get a deeper understanding about what you actually need, how to get the dependencies for various systems, including macOS, and then guides you through the complete configuration down to testing, installation, etc. Another point here is linking to Prisas. Linking to Prisas means how to use Prisas from a CIMIC project or from another project using package config. And finally, we have a section about the different language bindings, how to download them, how to install them. The final special systems page here contains supercomputers and clusters. So this is mostly a big archive of interesting information in case you want to compile precise on a specific cluster. Next up is the configuration. So the configuration is generally the same as in the wiki, it's just slightly polished. And we now have more advanced topics such as logging and export configuration, things like this. Furthermore, we have now an XML reference here that shows you the different tags with including description, what they mean. It's the same for the attributes, and also presents it with the different subtags and the allowed occurrence. And this can be very helpful if you need to configure something very specific. Furthermore, this is now integrated in the search. So if you search, for example, here for nearest neighbor, you can find the XML reference here. And clicking on it will just bring you straight to the correct tag. Next up is the tooling. So the tooling page contains mostly tools for the users, so like the config visualization, how to get it, how to install it, and some example usage cases here, like data flow visualization. Then what's completely new is the performance analysis. This basically tells you how to read the events output and how to process the JSON file into something that you can visualize in, for example, Chrome tracing. Next up, provided adapters. So the provided adapters list all the different adapters that we have for the different for different solvers. It refers to the original websites, to the code locations and documentation, and also gives you an overview and a guideline how to install the various adapters for these various solvers. KPLU Code is a complete page that's dedicated to you preparing and adapting your solver so that you end up with a workable adapter. It also covers some advanced topic like inter-implicit coupling, but also things like moving meshes, etc. And finally, we could come to the developer documentation. So the developer documentation contains everything related to the internals of Precise. So if you ever wanted to contribute to Precise, have a look at this part here, and you'll find coding conventions, formatting conventions, but also things like logging the timings and just release workflow, etc. So this could be very interesting for you. In general, what works on our website is the Edit Me button. So if you're ever not happy with the content of a website, just press this and it will bring you to GitHub, where you can poke the pen and then you can log in and edit the code and submit a pull request. And this leads me to the very happy announcement that Precise is still growing. So if you remember last year, we had the three parties. We had the Technical University of Munich, we had the University of Stuttgart, and then we had Benjamin Ueckermann at the Technical University of Eindhoven. And Benjamin Ueckermann is now became the lead of a new group for usability and sustainability of scientific software at the University of Stuttgart. And he already has two PhD candidates. So the first one is Ishin Desai, probably most known for his contribution towards the Phoenix adapter. And he starts his PhD with the topic of adaptive and flexible macro-micro coupling of software. And this is the exact topic that Benjamin Ueckermann will present later in a workshop. And another PhD candidate, which is probably also well known from the advancements into the world of D2, is David Schneider. And he will start his PhD with the topic of flexible and efficient data mapping for simulation of coupled problems, which will make a considered step into the direction of coupling particle codes, for example. So thank you very much for listening. My name was Felix Simonis, and I still wish you a nice workshop and wish you an excellent time.